It's a disease first detected in the gay community.
Almost all its victims were homosexual males.
The gay plague.
And at the faucet of all this, a 14-year-old boy, Ryan White. Ryan White, on the surface, appeared healthy, yet he'd been living with hemophilia his entire life, requiring weekly blood transfusions. Even with all of this, life was good, and he maintained an active lifestyle, but one day, his entire life as he knew it was capsized by one single needle. When Ryan was receiving one of his weekly transfusions, the needle that was injected into him carried the deadly HIV/AIDS virus. Suddenly, Ryan faced the hatred of his peers and their parents. He was ridiculed and no longer allowed to attend his school, all due to misinformation surrounding the AIDS/HIV virus. But how did this small town reach this level of hatred and misinformation? How were they able to treat a 14-year-old so ruthlessly? In order to fully grasp the explosive public reaction to the AIDS epidemic, it's critical to obtain knowledge of the disease's history in America and the world. AIDS is a zoonotic disease that can be traced all the way back to chimpanzees with what is known as simian immunodeficiency syndrome, which is a virus that attacks the immune system of monkeys and apes. So how did this harrowing illness stretch over the vast evolutionary lines between humans and monkeys? Scientists conclude that two strains of SIV combine to form a new variant, which can be transmitted between chimps and human beings. Allegedly, the disease entered the human population when African hunters consumed infected monkeys. There has been no significant evidence pointing to any potential first host. Yet, the first known outbreak was in 1920s Kinshasa, the largest urban center of the Democratic Republic of Congo. This would be one of AIDS' first steps around the globe, one of many that would soon outline a brutal path of destruction. AIDS soon traveled across oceans to America's Caribbean counterparts. When Haitian professionals returned home from the Democratic Republic of the Congo, making its mark further upward in the Western Hemisphere. AIDS was not only dangerous due to a lack of information on the disease, but also due to a lack of information on the disease's presence in 1970s America in cities like New York and San Francisco, an obliviousness that would not end until the early 1980s. The disease first became distinguishable to America's doctors when homosexual men came into emergency rooms in San Francisco with pneumocystis pneumonia, a type of pneumonia that only affects those with suppressed immune systems. As news of the disease ravaged America and cases spiked, it seemed that primarily homosexuals, those who'd used injectable drugs, and those who did not follow safe sexual practices were contracting the disease. HIV/AIDS was condemned to be a taboo topic, something that wasn't talked about in polite society. This lack of acknowledgement in all forms of life allowed stigma and hate to spread. The disease was viewed as something that only infected the immoral and increased the already rampant anti-homosexual ideology of the era. Early government inaction can also be attributed to the homophobic views surrounding the disease. When Ronald Reagan's press secretary was asked about the serious virus, he and the reporter had this interaction. The former president did not mention the devastating disease until 1985. By that time, the disease had already managed to kill 23,000 people in the United States. Little care was given to make sure the public was informed on the disease by their government, and in the early days of the epidemic, there were no effective treatments. It was only in 1987 that AIDS researchers discovered that the AZT drug could successfully halt the progression of HIV without harming the patient's normal cells. From there, other effective treatments began to emerge. These and other antiretroviral drugs were able to hand those who previously had no hope a new chance at life. The disease, which had previously brought the course of someone's life to an end in only a year, had been tamed to the state where a person diagnosed with HIV or AIDS could still live a long and healthy life. And as the medical side of the virus took a more positive turn, so did the ways American society viewed it. Though many Americans still displayed homophobic mindsets surrounding the disease, great progress had also been made. To learn more about the changing face of the virus on American society, we decided to interview Dr. Maria Young, who has spent years practicing medicine and has seen the faces of HIV/AIDS change in America.
When a new virus comes on the scene, for all of you guys, it seems like, oh, a new virus appears on the scene and boom, it can be identified. Boom, a vaccine is... That is not how things work. It was a completely different story. And back in the 80s and early 90s, we didn't even know it was a virus. We didn't know how it was spread. We didn't know any of those things. And so... people, the general population, were very afraid. They were afraid to shake people's hands. If you are asking how we could have initially stopped it, there was no way, because we had to figure out first what it was and how it was spread. And that took a long time.
Furthermore, America is looking promising for the future of AIDS and HIV treatment and prevention. PrEP treatments and more therapies are introduced, making America a world leader in terms of AIDS and HIV treatment. However, America is a lucky and wealthy country. Though AIDS treatments are expensive in America, they can be close to unobtainable in other parts of the world. To look at this, we shift across the Atlantic to the West African coast, looking at the powerful country of Nigeria. Nigeria is known as the wealthiest African nation, mainly due to two factors: its abundance of oil and its thriving culture. Even though its mass exportation of oil has historically brought in mass revenue, a deeper, darker issue hid deep beneath the government's foundation. And what finally brought it out? The AIDS crisis. The first two cases of AIDS in Nigeria were recognized in 1985, well after knowledge of the presence of the disease in America reached the globe. In 1986, the virus being in Nigeria was mentioned at an international conference, and just a year after, the Nigerian government established the National AIDS Advisory Committee and the National Expert Advisory Committee on AIDS. All seemed to be going well, as though Nigeria was learning from America's mistakes on how not to attack the outbreak. But unfortunately, the preceding actions would be the peak of federal recognition of and action against the AIDS crisis in 1980s Nigeria. Well, it all starts at the beginning, with the first two diagnoses in the country, one of which being a female sex worker. With this one case, a lethal public opinion was formed, one wrapped around the same American idea that AIDS solely affected those who did not practice sex in a proper and hygienic manner. The AIDS epidemic was then silenced in Nigeria, and to help explain how serious it was, Dr. Ejimole, a family physician in the popular city of Owerri, who has dealt with HIV-infected patients for decades, sat down to offer his standpoint.
Right now, I want to be honest with you, we have no government increase the next 1 year that can reduce the prevalence of HIV in Nigeria and reducing the number of people who contract it every year. There is no such government. That 2030, it is just about 8 years from now. It's not realizable in this country, except we have the change of government that is serious. Every sector of this economy has crumbled under the present leadership.
But in 1999, when candidate Obasanjo entered his presidency, his primary concern was the AIDS crisis. During his time in office, the President's Committee on AIDS and the National Action Committee on AIDS, or NACA, were founded. And just in 2001, the Nigerian government drafted a 3-year HIV/AIDS Emergency Action Plan. Although these seem like great milestones solely due to the fact the epidemic was recognized at a federal level, the organizations themselves and the results they produced in actually targeting the outbreak were utterly anticlimactic. It's estimated that just in the 2000s alone, there were 7 million HIV-infected individuals in Nigeria, only 10% of them receiving antiretroviral therapy, while only 7% of all pregnant women in the nation were notified of and received treatment options to reduce the risk of AIDS transmission to their infant children through breastfeeding. At this point, it was clear AIDS had taken root in the base of Nigeria and would not be expelled anytime soon. Unlike America, where many can receive education and medication for the disease, AIDS still remains a pressing, yet often ignored topic in Nigeria, something the government still has yet to fully target. Currently, there are over 1.9 million Nigerians infected with HIV, a disturbing number of them infants. The problem with AIDS is so rampant in Nigeria that the West African country contributes to 1 in every 4 cases of HIV-infected babies, the highest contributor in the world. It is evident that Nigeria still has a long uphill battle to fight to simmer the AIDS epidemic in the nation. But even in such a dark time, hope still remains. Our last stop is Thailand, a nation located in the southeast of Asia. The first case of HIV in Thailand sprouted in 1985, and to this day, it continues to have one of the highest numbers of cases in all of Asia and the better part of the Pacific. It is estimated that there are 470,000 infected individuals in Thailand, with approximately 14,000 deaths. Similar to America and Nigeria, the likelihood of contracting AIDS increases dramatically when one is plagued by poverty or lies on the margins of the country. In addition, Thailand is known for the heavy and dangerous stigmatization of those with the virus. However, unlike America and Nigeria, from the get-go, Thailand has made progressive and revolutionary endeavors to contain the disease in the nation's society. In 2006, the Thai government altered their healthcare system in order to incorporate services against HIV, mainly making testing, as well as treatment by antiretroviral medication, available to any possibly infected individual. And instead of attempting to silence AIDS like the Reagan administration, Thailand has partnered with civil society unions to provide knowledge of AIDS to the common public, and boasts an education and awareness program for preventative measures. Although there was a stigma in the country, it was substantially dismantled by both government recognition and movements led by the average citizen. And amazingly, but with little surprise, the preceding actions and initiatives have had outstanding results. With further analysis, one can see these amazing and distinguishing statistics are a direct result of common knowledge of the disease and government action. And one can see this as 80% of Thailand's population actively takes antiviral medication, and 78% of them have admitted the chances of HIV and other strains potentially progressing into AIDS in its full form. It's hard to believe more progress has come in recent years, but Thailand seems to have shattered previous expectations when it announced that less than 2% of modern-day children test positive for HIV after exposure. So what's next for Thailand? Well, even with its existing success, the Thai government wants to continue building upon previous advancements in order to further reduce the prevalence of HIV and AIDS in its society. The country has yet to reach the 90-90-90 targets made by the UNAIDS, whose goal is to have 90% of infected individuals aware of their HIV status, 90% on antiretroviral treatment, and 90% having suppressed viral loads. Even though there's a long way to go, Thailand has made the important action of setting a precedent that should be replicated internationally. Overall, one of the most common ideas in the fight against HIV and AIDS is government and society. Even today, AIDS and HIV is a disease either whispered in hushed tones or snickered at in unfeeling humor. The people who test positive for this disease are not immoral heathens or pitiful victims, they are people. It's impossible to know if Ryan White ever thought there would be a cure to the disease he advocated against for so long, fought against, and ultimately passed away from. However, even if no vaccine emerges, it's important that we live by his ideas of never giving up the fight and make AIDS something that is no longer whispered about.
All right.